The following podcast is part of a certified educational activity. Access the entire activity and complete the post-test at peerview.com/CHU860. Downloadable slides and practice aids are also available. Thank you for listening to PeerView Podcasts. We greatly appreciate your support and would like to hear from you. Can we ask for a favor? Participate today in a short one-minute survey at www.peerview.com/podcast survey to share how podcasts play a role in your medical education routine. Again, that's www.peerview.com/podcast survey to participate. And now on to today's podcast.
Hello, and welcome to How I Think, How I Treat in the New Age of AML Care. I am Dr. Harry Erba from Duke University Medical Center, and I am pleased to welcome my co-chair, Dr. Naval Daver from the MD Anderson Cancer Center, as well as our colleagues, Dr. Tara Lynn from the University of Kansas and Dr. Gail J. Robos from Weill Cornell Medical College and the New York Presbyterian Hospital. Let's now turn to the agenda for part one of this How I Think, How I Treat session. We are going to, in this part, explore induction options in higher risk patients eligible for intensive therapy, as well as post-remission options after intensive induction therapy. Where are we with maintenance? And I'm going to turn it over now to our colleague, Dr. Tara Lynn from the University of Kansas Medical Center in Kansas City, Kansas. And she's going to present on how I treat patients eligible for intensive therapy options in high-risk AML. Tara?
Thank you, Harry. I'm really looking forward to today's discussion. I'd like to talk about how I treat patients eligible for intensive therapy options in high-risk AML. When we look at the incidence of AML, you can see that higher-risk variants like secondary AML and treatment AML are a smaller proportion of the overall AML cases. But if you look at the survival curves, you can see that treatment-related AML and secondary AML, whether it's related to MDS or another bone marrow disorder, have worse outcomes than those patients with de novo disease. When we look at recent guidelines for higher risk AML, one thing to always keep in mind is that a clinical trial is really the preferred treatment for any patient with acute leukemia. When we're thinking about induction options for our older patients, a patient's age 60 and older, it's important to think about, are they a candidate for intensive therapy? If they are, it's also now important to assess some prognostic factors upfront before we determine our initial treatment strategy. Those patients with favorable risk disease are going to be recommended to have a classical 7-3 induction chemotherapy with the addition of gemtuzumab. Patients with FLT3 mutated disease, we will add midostaurin to their cytarabine and anthracycline. Those patients with unfavorable prognostic features have different treatment options, which sometimes includes lower intensity therapy such as a venetoclax-based regimen, even if they're eligible for intensive therapy, because sometimes intensive therapy is not as efficacious. These patients can sometimes be treated with a standard dose, a cytarabine and anthracycline. And now we recently have approved CPX-351, which is the liposomal formulation of 7-3 for patients with therapy-related or secondary AML. When we think about the updated guidelines for younger patients, again, the guidelines are always going to encourage participation in clinical trials. They will also include the addition of gemtuzumab for favorable risk patients, the addition of midostaurin for those patients with a FLT3 mutation. Nowadays, the guidelines for patients with unfavorable risk cytogenetics, monosomal karyotype, complex cytogenetics, and TP53 mutations are actually going to recommend an alternative induction strategy instead of traditional 7-3. The guidelines are not very specific about what this would be, and this continues to be an area of active investigation. When we look at the subgroup of patients who have a therapy-related AML, patients with prior chemotherapy, radiation therapy, a pre-existing bone marrow disorder, or those newly diagnosed patients who have MDS-related cytogenetic changes, The guidelines now recommend treatment with CPX-351. And I'll spend just a couple minutes and talk about the data in CPX-351 and how this has come to replace standard N3 for this specific subpopulation. CPX-351 is a liposomal formulation of cytarabine and daunorubicin, and it is formulated in the liposome to maintain this synergistic 5-to-1 ratio, which has enhanced uptake in the bone marrow in a longer time with the leukemia cells. In early phase studies, it was obviously tested first in the relapse refractory setting, and the MTD of 100 units per meter squared was selected. This is equivalent to 44 milligrams of daunorubicin, and then the drug is dosed at three doses during induction. In the phase two setting, patients with older patients with AML were randomized to either CPX-351 or 7N3, and a planned subset analysis showed that there were improved response rates, event-free survival, and overall survival, specifically in the secondary AML population. So the phase three study, which ultimately produced the data which led to the FDA approval, included this population. So these were patients ages 60 to 75, untreated AML with either treatment-related or a secondary AML from MDS, or patients with MDS-related cytogenetic changes. Over 300 patients were randomized, and the outcomes showed that CPX-351 prolonged the overall survival with a median overall survival of 9.56 months compared to 7N3 at 5.95 months. Data that's going to be presented at ASH gives us an update on these overall survival benefit. And you can see here now at more than 5 years of follow-up, the survival benefit is maintained across the entire cohort of this study. Interestingly, when you look at patients who got induction with either CPX or 7N3 and then went on to an allogeneic stem cell transplant, there is an additional survival benefit for those patients who received CPX-351 as their induction. And what you can see here on these curves is that the median overall survival for patients after a CPX induction followed by transplant has not yet been reached. And the patients who got a 7N3 induction followed by transplant, their median overall survival is just over 10 months. When we look at overall survival outcome by age group, this is also data to be presented at the meeting. The survival benefit is there in the age group 60 to 69, as well as 70 to 75. When we look at the outcomes across subgroups, I think it's important to note that therapy-related AML had a median overall survival of more than 12 months compared to 6 months when patients in this group were treated with 7N3. When you look at the subgroup of patients with MDS, there is a difference whether or not patients were treated with prior HMA. So you do see a survival benefit in patients with MDS who did not have prior HMA when they were treated with CPX-351. But if patients had MDS and had had prior HMA exposure, there really wasn't a benefit seen to CPX-351 induction over conventional 7N3. In the original publication from this phase three data, there was not much detail on the molecular mutations of the patients. And what we've seen in recent years, and this is data from last year's ASH, is some data regarding the genetic results of the patients in the trial. And you can see here that these were very high-risk patients. A third of them had mutations in TP53. 57% had secondary type mutations, with NPM1 only present in 6% of the patients. And this, you know, this data was not known at the time that patients were enrolled, but it seems that over time, these were relatively well-matched between the two groups. When we look at TP53 mutated patients in particular, you can see on this slide and in the next several, that the mutation patients are going to be in the solid lines and the not mutated patients are in the dashed lines. But, you know, from across the room, you can see that the mutated patients had an inferior overall survival. And unfortunately, the CPX-351 and 7N3 curves are right on top of each other, suggesting that there was no advantage to getting CPX induction for patients with a P53 mutation. When we look at secondary type and activated signaling mutations, again, the mutation patients are going to be in the solid line. You do see a benefit to patients with secondary type mutations who got CPX-351 induction over those who got a 7N3. When we look at those patients with an activated signaling mutation, you can see in the solid lines that they had inferior overall survival, whether or not they received CPX351 or 7 and 3. When we look at the safety data between the two arms, importantly, there was no increase in early mortality with CPX351, and there was actually a decrease in early mortality both at day 30 and at day 60. And overall, the AEs were what you would expect with leukemia induction, febrile neutropenia, infections, fatigue, and they were pretty similar between the two groups. What we do see with CPX351 induction is that there is a delayed count recovery compared to what we're used to with 7 and 3. And this is approximately 6 days longer that it takes patients to get to neutrophil recovery and platelet recovery. But importantly, this delayed count recovery didn't affect early mortality. The way that we take care of patients getting CPX351 induction here at KU is that the majority of patients are treated inpatient, both with their chemo and throughout their period of cytopenias through count recovery. We do have some patients who are known to our system, who've maybe been with us and followed for MDS. And so for those patients, we will offer them the idea of doing outpatient induction on days 1, 3, and 5. And then we follow them closely in our outpatient clinic, which is open 7 days a week, so that we can see them daily or every other day for labs and transfusions as needed. And then certainly if patients develop fever or other complications, we would admit them to the hospital. We do require that patients be within 30 minutes of our center and have a 24-hour caregiver so that someone's there to call 911 if they should have a fever, fall and hit their head while thrombocytopenic, something like that. The majority of our patients, like I mentioned, are going to be inpatient when they get their chemotherapy. We do have those rare patients who are sailing through their chemotherapy, have a day 14 bone marrow that does not require reinduction. They're not on any IV medications. They don't have any active infections. They live close. They have a caregiver. And those patients we will let discharge early and then again do that intensive clinic follow-up because we have that infrastructure to be able to see people 7 days a week. When we look at the phase 3 data, looking at CPX as consolidation, you can see again, you know, so the CPX induction could be followed by consolidation, which was given just on days 1 and 3 of those cycles. The median overall survival there was more than 25 months compared to patients who got 7 and 3 followed by 5 and 2 consolidation, which was 8.5 months. What's important to note is that many patients were able to successfully have a CPX consolidation as an outpatient and did not diminish their survival benefit. As we think about all the new drugs that we've seen approved since 2017 in AML, and you think about how most of them have been tested in the unfit setting or in patients or in combination with lower intensity therapy like HMA or low-dose ARA-C, it's certainly time that we start thinking about how are these drugs going to get integrated into our intensive chemotherapy strategies. And this is a trial I'd like to go over. This was just published earlier this year in 2020 from the group in Australia. This is the CAVIAT study where they're adding venetoclax to 5 and 2 induction. And so eligible patients for this trial had to either be ages 65 and older, or they could enroll at age 60 if they had a monosomal karyotype. So they were really reserving this treatment for patients they expected to be higher risk and maybe those who wouldn't get the same benefits out of traditional 7 and 3. Patients could get induction followed by consolidation as well as followed by maintenance. There was a dose escalation part to the study in that their successive cohorts would get increasing doses of venetoclax, with the last cohort being treated at a dose of 600 milligrams. All patients got a 7-day prephase, followed by an additional 7 days of venetoclax, 5 days of cytarabine, and then 2 days of idarubicin. When we look at the response rates, so this is showing the complete remission, the CR plus CRI rates are listed there across the top. And so the overall response rate was 72% across all the groups. When we look at those patients with de novo AML, they had a 97% CR plus CR rate. Not surprisingly, patients with secondary AML and adverse risk features had lower CR and CRI rates at 43% and 44% respectively. There was no difference. They did their age cutoff at age 75. No difference in response rates if patients were older or younger than 75. So this is certainly interesting as we think about how to take some of these newer agents and incorporate them into intensive chemotherapy. When we look at the safety data, obviously there were hematologic toxicities, as you would expect, and then common adverse events like febrile neutropenia and infection. What the authors did notice, though, is that they didn't see a difference really in terms of platelet recovery from what they would expect during induction, but in the consolidation cycles, there was a longer time to platelet recovery. Because they had that venetoclax single-agent prephase, they were able to assess the effects of venetoclax alone in these patients and saw that there were marrow blast reductions of more than 50% in patients with NPM1, IDH2, and SRSF2 mutant AML. When we think about what else are we doing with intensive therapy, I want to mention another study that's ongoing, the VFAST trial. And so this is taking patients 18 and older who are fit for intensive chemotherapy, and it is giving them CPX-351 in combination with one of our newer agents. So patients with FLT3 mutations are getting the addition of midostaurin. Those with an IDH2 mutation have enasidenib added. And then those patients without IDH2 and without FLT3 are going on to a venetoclax arm, regardless of what other mutations they have. The study is ongoing and enrolling patients at this time. So when we talk about secondary AML, we sort of have, you know, kind of two different kinds of patients that I want to survey the group and see how everyone is treating these. You know, when you think about a classic treatment-related AML, a patient with breast cancer who got some adjuvant anthracycline therapy and then presents with a newly diagnosed AML, if this patient is fit and a transplant candidate, I think, you know, the phase 3 data from the CPX trial, you know, would really say that this is a great patient for a treatment like that, and we would recommend an allo transplant in most cases. On the other hand, when you have a patient who has a secondary AML arising out of an MDS and has gotten prior HMA therapy and now has an AML, I think it's a little bit less clear what's the ideal treatment for this patient. We don't see the same benefit to CPX-351 as we see in other subtypes. Do we give them an HMA-based regimen with something else, even though they were just on an HMA? Obviously, if we have clinical trials, that's always what we would prefer in these patients. These patients who've gotten a lot of HMA and then have a secondary AML, you know, aren't going to do as well, whatever treatment we choose. But I'm curious to survey the panel and see how you guys are treating these patients as well.
Well, thanks, Tara. I think I'll jump in to begin with. And let's start with the patient on the left. What's curious about her presentation is this is a woman who had breast cancer and adjuvant therapy with a topoisomerase II inhibitor just 2 years ago. And you don't mention that she had a smoldering, you know, pancytopenia. It's only a 2-year latency. And so when I see a patient like this, I'm going to really wait for the genomic analysis to come back. Based on what you presented with CPX-351 from Coleman-Lindsley's data, if this turned out to be a TP53 mutated AML because of the cyclophosphamide, for example, she received with that regimen, I'd be a lot less inclined to give that patient CPX-351. On the other hand, if the patient had an E2016, which clearly can happen with topo 2 inhibitors, I might go with curative therapy in that patient, give that patient CPX-351 with gem. I'm going to go on out on the limb, CPX-351 with gemtuzumab, or just 7 and 3 with gemtuzumab in that subset. And so I'm being purposely controversial here in that choice. But I did want to bring up whether using a FISH analysis and mutational analysis might show, help us choose the right therapy for a patient like this. I'd be curious about others.
Yeah, no, you absolutely make a great point. And I should have emphasized that more, that, you know, it's so important that now that we have all of these tools at our disposal and we know better, who is less likely to respond to something and who's more likely to respond to something. You know, we've really changed the way that we do things, right? It used to be, you know, that someone came in with AML and they were getting chemotherapy by 6 p.m. that night. And now we're really taking our time and making sure that we have FISH for core binding factor, that we have the FLT3, that we have the TP53 before we get started.
I think it also brings up an interesting discussion of, so your purple part or dark purple part says, you know, the patient is fit, and yet fit, unfit always matters, right? I mean, you have to be in shape for therapy, but I think that what one wants to kind of start wondering is whether some of the HMA plus venetoclax plus whatever, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit later in the discussion, but okay, so she's 50. So what? She already had an anthracycline. Might there be a rationale to take a patient with a secondary disease and use an HMA ven? And I will confess to having done that with a patient in her 40s who had been through the ringer with a ton of other chemotherapy and radiation therapy related to lymphoma. But I think it begs the question of, again, we're used to buckets. We're used to, well, this is what you've got to be. You've got to be frail and you've got to be old and you've got to have 43 problems in order to get this therapy. But actually, not necessarily so, right? We're trying to go for biology here. So I would say that while CPX can be a consideration, HMA-Ven can be a consideration as well. Just because somebody is 50 doesn't mean that's taken off the table, I guess, is the point that I would make, although that is not consistent currently with the label.
Yeah, I mean, just to, you know, highlight what Gail is saying, I think similarly, I think the biology is really what would drive our selection. And Harry kind of mentioned, so, you know, we'd look at core binding factor. If he has that, then a flag GO or 3+7 GO kind of approach. If he has FLT3, I would probably go for induction with the FLT3. Now, could you do CPX with FLT3 in a trial setting? Yes. And then if he has TP53, for sure, that's when I would think of a trial with either APR or magrolimab kind of approach. So I think biology is really what, biology meaning molecular and cytogenetics, is what would help me select. And you know, the fitness unfitness arguments is not one that we are really using too much at MD Anderson. I mean, you can be fit, you have to be fit to receive induction chemotherapy, but you could be fit and not benefit from induction chemotherapy. And I think that's, you know, the issue. And especially with some of these triplets coming, again, it's early days, but could some of these, especially with IDH, FLT3, TP53 drugs be equal or better? I guess that's kind of what we're leaning on for these very high-risk patients today. But I think those are things we will know in the next couple of years.
Okay, let's get to our other case. I think the low-hanging fruit there for a patient with MDS that progresses would be to hope to find an IDH or a FLT3 or something that you could target, but that's often not the case. So Tara, I want to turn it back to you. I know the Jeff Lancet paper, and I know in patients who had prior HMA, there did not seem to be a benefit of CPX-351 over 7 and 3. But I could have sworn I saw another analysis that I think you were involved in that questioned if that's true or not. Or am I mistaken?
I have definitely seen a couple of other series. There is... there will be some groups who really say there's not benefit, and then others who say there are. So I think we don't have a big enough subset to really come down. And it's, you know, the data from CPX just shows that there's not an advantage over 7 and 3. It's not that there's, you know, that there isn't, you know, a 40-something percent remission rate, and then you could take someone on to something else or continue them on. I think where we struggle is, you know, a lot of these patients, I mean, if they have a TP53 mutation, well, then it's easier not to recommend a traditional induction with 7 and 3 or with CPX. But when you've had somebody who's had a fair amount of HMA, and then to put them onto something else with an HMA, when we know that, you know, for a lot of the venetoclax-based trials, you know, some of those trials had prior HMA patients excluded, it's not completely clear, I think, what we should do. And I feel like we see more and more clinical trials that are excluding those patients, worried that, you know, assuming that their outcomes are going to be worse, so we'll just take them off the table, and we don't get clean data sets with good answers for them.
It's also a very heterogeneous population. Is this a patient who went into a remission and 12 months later relapsed, never having infections and not needing transfusions? Or is this somebody who got 12 months of azacitidine because they were quote unquote stable and suffering for all the infectious complications? And I think we don't have that kind of granularity to the data that will allow us to make those kind of, you know, treatment decisions.
I have had some people suggest that maybe like a Glastigib induction for someone who's had prior HMA would be the way to go. That's not what we're doing here in our practice. I'm not sure if anybody on our panel is using Glastigib in that way or at all.
Well, I mean, I think there the discussion would be in combination with low-dose cytarabine, for example, for venetoclax also. So just taking a non-HMA-based. I think that when people see a TP53 mutation, you just are groaning with any chemotherapy. And I think the presence of prior HMA treatment just biologically defines those patients as having difficulty with everything. I would say that there is, at our site, there has been more of a trend to use a VLEC type of approach, just because we happen to participate in that study. So we had put a lot of patients onto the combination of low-dose cytarabine plus venetoclax and had a lot of experience with that. So there's perhaps a little bit of a bias that when they've had 50 cycles of HMA to go that route, rather than I have less experience going a different direction with Glastigib. I definitely think that for general emphasis, the point is that number one, dig for that biology because somebody might have a mutation that's helpful. Obviously, the clinical trials here are of critical importance. And I would argue that here is where we would love some immunotherapy to kick in and take us in a different direction. The king of immunotherapy is on our panel, and I'm scowling because I still don't have the immunotherapy that I would want to be able to say to somebody, okay, let's go in a totally different direction and give you a checkpoint inhibitor or an ADC or something else. But I think that's where we would like to be in a different land with this type of patient and be able to go a completely different non-HMA-based, not cytarabine-based, different mechanism route that I think we don't fully have yet.
And now I'm going to move on to how I am treating patients eligible for intensive therapy, but look at newer post-remission options. So here you see the NCCN guidelines for post-remission therapy in AML for patients over the age of 60. And allogeneic transplant is listed at the top of this list. And we know that allogeneic transplant is associated with the lowest risk of relapse, but unfortunately it has significant morbidity and mortality associated with it. And when we're talking about patients at in later years of life with comorbidities and strained financial and social situations, this becomes a difficulty for many of our patients to actually proceed to. And there have been a number of studies that looked at how many patients actually get to allogeneic transplant. And in general, I think we could all agree it's the minority. It's well less than 50% of patients in this age group. Keeping in mind that the median age of AML is 68, this is clearly an unmet need. Now, what do we have otherwise? Well, you can continue basically with a consolidation strategy that's informed by your initial induction. And so for patients with core binding factor leukemias, you can consider going on with intermediate dose Ara-C or standard dose cytarabine anthracycline with gemtuzumab. If they had a FLT3 mutation, continue on with intermediate dose cytarabine with midostaurin. If you started with CPX351 because the patient had therapy-related AML or AML-MRC, again, you can give up to two cycles of CPX351 in that situation. And then we're left with data that supports using maintenance therapy with hypomethylating agents or oral azacitidine, which I'm going to come to. So let's look at some recent developments in post-remission maintenance. As you all know, the RATIFY trial continued patients into their maintenance with a one-year randomization between oral midostaurin versus placebo. What was interesting about that analysis is shown here. Dick Larson presented at ASH 3 years ago a landmark analysis of patients at the end of that 1 year of maintenance. and showed that when patients stopped midostaurin, there was a very precipitous drop off in the next several weeks of with relapse in those patients. Azacitidine maintenance and other HMA maintenance has been evaluated after intensive chemotherapy. The German AML study group was the first to show that it actually does improve disease-free survival. Now, in this study, they took a group of patients who were older but fit for intensive chemotherapy. According to German protocols, they received two cycles of induction chemotherapy. No one got consolidation. And then they were randomized between observation and azacitidine 50 milligrams per meter squared by subcutaneous injection daily for 5 days for up to 12 cycles. And as you can see here, there was an improvement in disease-free survival with 64% at 12 months still alive and disease-free after azacitidine and only 42% in the control group. There did not seem to be an improvement, however, in overall survival. In the ECOG-ACRIN 2906 trial, decitabine maintenance was evaluated in older patients. Now, you may remember this study as a study of fit patients over the age of 60 randomized to receive 7 and 3 induction chemotherapy followed by intermediate dose cytarabine versus single agent clofarabine induction and consolidation. In my opinion, not a very fair comparison. And the result was, as you might expect, the median survival was actually longer with 7 and 3 followed by intermediate dose cytarabine. It was 14 months median survival compared to 10 months with clofarabine. Now, that study closed because it did not meet its primary endpoint of improvement in overall survival. However, there was this secondary randomization for patients over the age of 60 with a bone marrow biopsy confirmed CR/CRI after consolidation, and they received 3 days of decitabine versus observation. This was presented by our colleague, Dr. James Ferran, at last year's ASH symposium. And as you can see here, there really wasn't a statistically significant improvement in either disease-free or overall survival. There was a trend towards improvement in disease-free and overall survival, but this study did not prove a benefit of decitabine in a subset of patients with FLT3-negative AML. There was apparently a benefit of decitabine in that subset of patients. But unfortunately, because the study was closed to further accrual, we really can't answer the question of decitabine maintenance very effectively. But what James concluded was that there was superior overall survival, although the p-value above 0.05, there was a trend for improved disease-free survival, again, with a p-value of 0.12, and there was a significant overall survival improvement for FLT3-ITD negative patients receiving decitabine as a maintenance therapy for 1 year. However, the study that has led to the approval of a continuing therapy, what the rest of us would call maintenance therapy in acute myeloid leukemia, is the QUASAR study. This was an international phase 3 study that looked to improve the survival of patients with AML in first complete remission after intensive induction and consolidation. Patients had to be over the age of 55. They could not have core binding factor leukemias. 20% of them only received induction, but 80% received 1, 2, or 3 cycles of consolidation. Patients were randomized between CC486 or oral azacitidine, 300 milligrams daily for 14 days versus placebo for 14 days on a 28-day cycle until unacceptable side effects or progression. If a bone marrow, interim bone marrow showed an increase in the bone marrow blasts from less than 5% to 5 to 15%, the dose of CC4086 could be increased to 21 days. However, I will say that this did not end up in the label for oral azacitidine. The primary endpoint of the study was met. There was an improvement in the median overall survival of patients receiving oral azacitidine being just over 2 years, 24.7 months, versus 14.8 months with placebo. Now, what's interesting about these Kaplan-Meier curves is that although there's clearly an improvement in median survival, and at 1 and 2 years, more patients were alive if they were randomly assigned to receive oral azacitidine, you could see that by 4 to 5 years into the study, there's still about 10% of patients, but the overall survival is only about 20% in both groups. So it suggests to me that the real benefit of oral azacitidine is to delay relapse. And that was actually shown in the presentation by Andrew Wei in the late-breaking abstracts at ASH, where the median relapse-free survival was 10.2 months with CC486 versus 4.8 months with placebo. At 1 year, the relapse rate was 53% with CC486 versus 71% with placebo. Now, in terms of the safety, I think this is the issue that will be facing our patients. They've now finished induction and consolidation, have had all of the complications that we typically see, and they are being offered an oral therapy that may not go further to cure them, but does appear to delay relapse. And there are toxicities associated with this. And the two that I would focus on are the GI toxicities and the myelosuppression. So you can see nausea seen in 2/3 of patients with vomiting and 60%, diarrhea, constipation, abdominal discomfort occurred. And in fact, in the label, it is recommended that patients receive antiemetic prophylaxis with each dose of oral azacitidine for the first 2 cycles, and then it can be discontinued if the patient is no longer experiencing nausea. In terms of the myelosuppression, 50% of patients developed an ANC under 500, and 25% of patients developed a platelet count under 50,000. So let me say that again, 50% developed an ANC under 1,000, grade 3 toxicity, and 25% developed thrombocytopenia grade 3 with a platelet count under 50,000. Now think about what that means for a patient. They have a competing risk for the cytopenias, and that is relapse. And so when this happens, and if it doesn't get better with holding the drug, which is recommended, then this will lead to a bone marrow biopsy looking for relapse. But based on this large international study, CC486 was FDA approved on September 1st, 2020 for the continued treatment of patients with AML in first CR or CRI following intensive induction chemotherapy who are unable to complete intensive curative therapy. And as I pointed out earlier, only 2 out of over 200 patients actually had therapy-related AML. Only 15%, as you might expect, had poor risk AML. Because remember, these patients would have to have received intensive therapy and then achieved a remission. So that's going to select against poor risk AML. And only 10% had what the authors considered secondary AML. So with that, we now have a new option that for 40 years, we've basically never have had in the treatment of patients with AML who've received intensive chemotherapy, who have not gone on to curative therapy, which is allogeneic transplant. And what I want to present to the group here are a couple of recent patients. Now, I will be honest with you, I was not an investigator on this study. And so my experience with CC486 is quite limited since its FDA approval on September 1st. But we have Gail Robos with us, and I'm not sure if my other two colleagues were actually investigators on the study. So I'm going to turn to them and have them help me with how I can do better. Let me show you the two patients where I considered CC486. The first is a 51-year-old woman, normal karyotype with a RUNX1 mutation, as well as 5 other pathogenic mutations. She receives 7 and 3, achieves a remission with MRD by flow. She receives 3 cycles of high-dose cytarabine consolidation. And at the end of that, we repeat a marrow. By flow cytometry, it's negative. And actually, the myeloid gene panel by NGS is negative, although recalling that you would need at least 2.5% variant allelic frequency to be seeing those mutations on a next-gen panel. But she declined allotransplant in July due to lack of caregiver. In fact, she was the caregiver for her husband with cardiomyopathy, as well as the risks. She subsequently, at that time, when it became available, so a couple months later, declined oral azacitidine due to the risks that I mentioned, GI toxicity and myelosuppression, and worried that she would have to take time off from work. And unfortunately, she developed progressive pancytopenia 4 months after the end of therapy marrow, and that was due to relapse. Just one other case, and then I'll open it up to my colleagues to help me understand how we're going to use this drug to improve survival of AML patients fit for intensive chemotherapy. So this is a 71-year-old man with AML with normal karyotype, otherwise very healthy, didn't see doctors, had no history of cytopenias, and had pathogenic mutations in 6 different genes, including a low allelic ratio of FLT3-ITD with a nucleophosmin IDH2, as well as JAK2, SRSF2, and TET2. So based on the presence of an FLT3-ITD, I treat him with cytarabine and daunorubicin with midostaurin. He has polymicrobial sepsis, but survives this. He achieves a remission, but the remission marrow showed clustering of atypical megakaryocytes. The MRD was negative by flow cytometry. The pathologist wonders if there's an underlying MPN. And in fact, now the myeloid gene panel does not detect FLT3 nucleophosmin IDH2 mutations, which probably were part of the leukemic progression, but still detects JAK2, SRSF2, and TET2. So he goes on to receive 2 cycles of high-dose cytarabine with midostaurin. He declines allotransplant due to social issues, mostly because he's the caregiver for his 90-year-old mother who lives close to him. And he considers oral azacitidine, actually gets the prescription in his pocket, but then he develops recurrent cytopenias. A repeat marrow, however, just shows a hypoplastic marrow with persistence of those mutations. And so those are, you know, 2 of my patients recently that I've considered for oral azacitidine. And I really want to turn first to Gail, who was one of the investigators on the QUASAR study. Does my experience match some of your experience putting patients on the study? And what else can you tell us?
The first patient first. So the first patient should have had an allo stem cell transplant, obviously, with a RUNX and 5 other mutations and so forth. That wasn't going to go well. Just to be clear, for QUASAR, so these were patients who were deemed ineligible for transplant. And while there are some who got into that category because of declining it, that is not a majority. And certainly there is every possible caveat to all of the excellent results of QUASAR, saying that if the patient can have potentially curable, you know, curative therapy, they should. Now, if she absolutely didn't want to have a stem cell transplant, and I certainly get that, stem cell transplant's awful and miserable, and she has a husband who needs help at home, and maybe it was just simply impossible. I've actually, I feel, yeah, and my bias here, just to say, is that it so happens that the longest patient on the trial in the United States happens to be my patient, who is 7.5 years in and on cycle, I don't know, 90-something or whatever the number is. So this is a tolerable drug. And I would say that I don't consider patient number 2 on your list having cytopenias. I wouldn't even count those as cytopenias. I mean, you know, an ANC of 1200 and platelets of 75 to me sounds great. That patient's not going to get any trouble, even if he goes skydiving and motorcycle jumping. He'll probably be okay. And on the first patient, I would kind of argue that there was quite a bit of clustering of the toxicities, especially the GI toxicity was early on, and patients generally found, and many of my investigators have found this with their patients, that a little bit of tweaking of certain things, whether it was taking the pills at nighttime with your bowl of ice cream or without your bowl of ice cream, there were little tweaky things that actually made a very big difference with respect to GI tolerability. So I think that those issues are very manageable. Also, on the cytopenia front, actually, there was a lot of clustering of the cytopenias at the time when the patients were relapsing. And if you go through and comb through the data very carefully, the number of significant cytopenia-related complications that resulted in drug discontinuation or in major issues was actually vanishingly small. And we have to present the data as they are, but it turned out that most of the cytopenias actually turned into relapse rather than unmanageable drug-related cytopenias. So I would argue that lady number one would probably, we're not going to cure her, I think, with her constellation of mutations and disease, but we might have delayed relapse successfully. I'm also presenting, I don't know if you cited that abstract, but I will be presenting at ASH in one of the orals on the MRD data for Quasar, which I think are interesting for patients. I'm presenting flow data initially, not molecular yet. But I think that patients can be guided with reasonably easy maneuvering through the toxicity. And I think that the second gentleman, this should be manipulable. Interestingly, I wouldn't have treated this patient with intensive chemotherapy at all. At my institution, this patient would have gotten HMA plus venetoclax, plus possibly totally off-label, and now I'm on camera and the police will come and take me away. But we might have sprinkled in a little bit of guilt in here too. But this patient with an NPM1 and an IDH would have actually had venetoclax-based induction. And then the question would have been, which nobody knows the answer to, that would his ongoing therapy be the combination of venetoclax and the HMA, or just HMA alone based on Quasar? And our current practice has been that for patients who are started on AZA and venetoclax combinations who are doing well, that they continue the doublet actually and don't just, they don't drop the venetoclax based on just experience with that regimen, not any type of comparison with oral azacitidine.
Novel, you were nodding your head.
Yeah, I think for patient two, that's probably where I was nodding my head. Yeah, 71-year-old, we would probably go for an HMA ven. And we would we have a trial, so it would go on a trial, but a HMA ven guilt approach or an HMA ven IDH2 approach is kind of what I think we would have preferred. And then the questions are, you know, you give 4 or 5 cycles of that, and then a lot of these people are in deep remission, MRD negative. Do you continue? They start asking questions. Can I switch to oral something? Do you do CC486 alone? Do you do CC486 plus an IDH? You know, these are the kind of questions we're starting to get. But I think I probably wouldn't we give induction to this patient. We have used CC486. We were a center for Hadrawandi from our group, was the PI here at MD Anderson. And as Gail said, I mean, tolerability-wise, it's in general been very well-tolerated drug, has been my impression. I mean, there are people who have some GI side effects. You adjust the doses accordingly, and often it improves. Cytopenias, I don't think we had any patient that had to come off due to cytopenias. It was quite manageable. So all in all, I think it's a very good strategy. I think the data is positive, but the struggle we're having at MD Anderson is to find those patients because, you know, the patients who are young and fit, we give them induction, they get into a nice remission. 70, 80% of them, you know, they are able to go to transplant. There are some people who fall apart during induction consolidation. It's not a majority, maybe 10% or 15%, and then, okay, we cannot take them to transplant. That's where it fits in. And those above, I mean, the battleground really for us has become 60 to 70. Above 70, I think HMA ven plus is it. And 60 to 70, there's movement if they have a FLT3 IDH, TP53 to go to the HMA ven triplet. And so then they're getting that and going to transplant or not. So it's becoming hard for us to find that 50 to 70 who got induction, doesn't want to go to transplant or can't go to transplant. Yeah.
We still give intensive induction to older people. If Harry, if your patient had been with us, we would have treated him with intensive induction. We're transplanting up to 75, 76. I think people can, you know, I think that you can look at the CR rates to intensive induction and compare it to the CR rates that we see with HMA venetoclax, but we don't have the data head to head, and you can parse the subsets over and over again, and I just don't think it's completely clear, and I don't know that we'll ever get the data. And I feel like the horse is out of the barn on HMA venetoclax, and because it's easier to take and people can do it outpatient, that things are moving that way. But we have not completely moved that way at all.
So here you see the real world discussion, right? Yeah.
Well, exactly. I mean, this is what the challenge is for everyone. Where do we, you know, it's easy when you have a 78-year-old, but this is the gray zone, in my opinion. And, you know, you never know that it, you know, just remembering my conversations with this man, he was, you know, just shaking in his boots during that entire initial conversation. So, you know, thinking down the road, I can think down the road. You can think down the road. He can't possibly think down the road. And so the choice I made actually was to give him time-limited therapy that honestly, I do have patients like this that are long-term survivors in my clinics at Michigan and UAB who've received intensive chemotherapy. Now that I know that he has those other mutations and that when he went in remission, he has this clustering of the megakaryocytes, obviously a different story, but we don't always have that data on day one.
Thank you very much, Dr. Erba. I think this has been a great discussion. We have questions coming in at this time, and we'll take those at the end of the panel. So now we're going to move to part two. This is going to cover two major areas of development and exciting updates in acute myeloid leukemia. One is novel antibody-based therapies, including immunotherapies, where they are and how will they make a difference. And the next one that Dr. Robos will be covering are with novel targeted therapies and combinations of those, including BCL2, FLT3, IDH inhibitors, and others. So I'll be discussing the antibody-based therapies in the acute myeloid leukemia setting. So there's a number of different antigen targets that have been identified, as you can see from this slide, CD33, CD123, more recently CD47, CD70, and even FLT3 have been used as antigen markers for directed antibody therapy, either with antibody drug conjugates, bispecific antibodies, or with enhancing strategies that activate macrophages or T cells, such as is being done with CD47 or CD70. The only antibody or immune therapy per se that is approved right now in acute myeloid leukemia is gemtuzumab ozogamicin. This is an antibody drug conjugate that targets CD33 expressed heavily on the surface of acute myeloid leukemia cells and delivers a toxin, calicheamicin, into the acute myeloid leukemia cell, causing destruction of the cell. It has a very long and colored history, was initially approved in 2001 in the U.S., was off-market in 2010, and is now reapproved in 2017. And most of the data that led to the reapproval of gemtuzumab was based on four or five large European frontline studies that combined gemtuzumab with a backbone of induction chemotherapy, such as 7+3 or other induction backbones, all showing an improvement in survival without an increase in early mortality with the addition of gemtuzumab. But when we look at the meta-analysis, which is a very nice analysis done across 3,300 patients, what we saw is that the maximum benefit of gemtuzumab is in the patients who have favorable risk, core binding factor, NPM1 mutated, FLT3 wild type of AML, where you see a clear survival benefit. This was shown by the Alpha study in the French cooperative group, and we have seen similar improvement in survival with the FLAG-based backbone adding gemtuzumab that was presented by Dr. Borthiger from our group at the last ASH. So I think this is probably where gemtuzumab has its own maximum role in the frontline core binding. Now, there is benefit in the intermediate cytogenetics, and one could use it there, and rarely have we used it in relapse, although the label does give you allowance to use that. So now moving to the adverse population of AML. This is an area of major unmet need. So these are two data sets looking at HMA venetoclax, which you've already heard we are all super excited about, we think is a major breakthrough across AML. However, the one group where unfortunately it has not shown a great improvement, and some will argue no improvement based on some of the data that will be at ASH this year, is in TP53 mutated AML. So this is the first study is one that was looking at the phase 1b study of HMA venetoclax, looking at different molecular groups. As you can see, the TP53 population had a lower response rate, about 50 to 55% CR/CRI is what was shown in this study, as well as in the Viale study. And the median overall survival was about 6 months. There will be a presentation at ASH by one of our fellows, Dr. Kim, and she looked at our DAC 10-day venetoclax experience, 120 patients. Among those patients, Those who had TP53 mutation was about 30 patients or so. You can see the median overall survival is quite dismal, 5 months versus 19 months. And actually, we compared this to patients who had received single agent DAC 5 or 10 days. And actually, there is no difference. The survival is about 5 months. So I think TP53 mutated patients remain a very, very difficult subset, even with the emergence of HMA venetoclax. So there are two strategies that many of us are excited about and hope will be eventually breakthroughs for TP53 AML. The data is still early and emerging. One of them is an antibody immune type therapy. This is a drug called magrolimab. This is one of many CD47 SIRP alpha targeting agents that has now entered clinical trials in acute myeloid leukemia. And the way it works is very similar conceptually to PD-1, PD-L1 in T cells. So basically, what we're doing is blocking the interaction between CD47 on the surface of tumor cell and SIRP alpha on the surface of macrophages. And by blocking that interaction, you are unleashing the macrophages or allowing them to do their phagocytic function in a normal way. So there's been a lot of preclinical data published on this by the group at Stanford and others over the last 10 years. And this has led to now ongoing clinical trials. The trial in AML, there's two trials, one in MDS, one in AML, two arms of that trial. The MDS study is actually more advanced. However, there is a frontline AML study ongoing. This was last updated at ASCO and EHA. And this was in about 30 patients with acute myeloid leukemia, older patients not fit for intensive induction. And initially, the study allowed all patients, irrespective of mutation. But as we started seeing a signal that was more favorable in TP53 mutation and a potential path for approval for this drug, the study has now been enriched and only allows frontline TP53 mutated AML not suitable for induction. And that's why you see this higher proportion of TP53 in adverse cytogenetics, 72% with adverse and 45% with TP53. So this is the data that was presented at ASH, at EHA. There is an update at ASH that will be focusing only on TP53 mutated AML. There's about 36 or 37 patients there. The abstract is out. But what was presented at EHA, we saw the overall response rate was about 60-65%. However, in TP53, the CR/CRR rate appears to be encouraging, 75%, small numbers at that time. Now with about 30-plus patients, it's around 70-71%, and we do see MRD negativity in half of these patients. But really, I think what's encouraging is the durability so far of the responses. We are seeing now with a six-month follow-up that about 90% of those patients have maintained the response. The median follow-up is about 10 months. So hopefully with more follow-up, we will get clearer data. And there is molecular sequencing being done showing that majority of these patients, about 80%, clear the TP53. Safety-wise, this is, to me, actually, I think the safety profile of this combination has been what's most exciting. We've treated about 50 or more patients now at MD Anderson and really quite well tolerated, even easier to manage the neutropenias, thrombocytopenias than our experience with HMA-VEN. However, we do see an early onset on-target anemia from clearance of red cells. This is usually most profound in the first 8 to 10 days, then usually gets better by the end of the second week. And we haven't had any discontinuations, but it is one thing to be quite aware of. Other than that, quite well tolerated, and only one patient so far has discontinued in the multicenter effort. And I think the early mortality was around 3-4%, which is quite good. The other approach that's also quite exciting for TP53 mutated AML is not an immunotherapy per se. It's more of a protein targeted approach. It's with a drug called APR246. This is data that was presented by David Salmon at ASH. There was an update from a French study at EHA this year with this compound. Most of the data is in MDS, majority of the patients, but as you can see, very high response rates, and the survival also is above 12 months, which whether it's MDS or AML, TP53 mutated, appears to be quite encouraging. So this has actually completed an MDS phase 3 of AZA plus or minus APR, and we're actually hoping to see that data very soon, maybe as early as January. And we hope that one or two of these strategies could be quite important for TP53. So here I'm going to kind of talk a little bit about a patient case, and I'll turn it over to our panel to see their thoughts and how they would approach a similar patient. So this is a patient we saw a couple of months ago, 73-year-old, who came in with weakness, shortness of breath. You see pancytopenia on the counts. has a normal kidney function, good ECOG performance status, and has a prior history of Hodgkin's lymphoma treated many years ago. Has some comorbidities, but nothing in the recent past, no major medical surgical issues in the recent times. And we did a bone marrow, rushed the cytogenetics, got them back on around 3 days, showing deletion 7, 5, and 17, so multiple bad actors. And we have a NGS panel that comes usually around 6-7 days, and this is what it showed, TP53 and the ASXL1 mutation. So before moving to the next slide, I'll turn it over, maybe start with Dr. Erba. What are your thoughts on such a patient? What would you consider for this 73-year-old?
Well, I think there's no doubt in this situation. This is a patient who's going to do poorly with any regimen. If you're not fortunate enough to have access to APR-246 and anti-CD47, then I would start with an HMA and venetoclax. The response rates are still 50 to 60%, but we all know they're quite short-lived. I think we really need to prioritize clinical trials for these patients with the various CD47 antibodies that are out there. APR-246, I think, is tied up in a large phase 3 study now, so it's not, it's at least for mortals among us, novel, not the MD Anderson crew. It's hard for us to get our hands on that drug for our patients. So, that's what I would be thinking about for this patient.
Gail, any thoughts?
Well, I mean, I definitely would want to have a patient like this on a trial, but my thoughts immediately go to kind of what's supposed to happen is you're supposed to do something and then do a transplant. And that's, I hate myself for that thought, because I find, unfortunately, with many of these patients that even when they are in, even in a VAF negative complete remission, somehow the transplant just doesn't work and they relapse even after transplant. So I think that we desperately need ongoing strategies also for the patients who are managing to get into remission, because these patients do get into remission and the temptation, it feels like you should transplant them when they're VAF negative. If they clear their cytogenetics, that feels like what we have to do. And yet I feel that so many of those patients also relapse. So for me, the what can we do afterwards to prolong those remissions more meaningfully than a transplant, I think matters. It does also matter, it's been shown to matter, what the VAF level is at the beginning here. And I think it's not true also that all TP53 mutations are the same. So I think it's worth it to dig hard with the molecular pathologist initially to make sure that which TP53 is this and what, is there any wiggle room on the prognosis? Of course, here you have an antecedent malignancy and you have multiple karyotypic abnormalities with it. But I just wanted to make the point that not all TP53 is the same, and we shouldn't just, we should dig deep and try to find any possible silver lining, I think, although in this patient, I'm afraid it won't be there.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. Yeah, and there are two data sets out as to what Dr. Bose is mentioning, one from Moffitt, one from our group, looking at all our TP53 patients. And there is a small group, about 15% or so, that have low TP53 VAF, less than 40%, or have a single TP53 or don't have associated adverse cytogenetics, that actually seem to do quite well, as good as non-TP53. So absolutely, I mean, if we can identify those patients and we're lucky, those could be people you could still consider intensive therapy. Dr. Lin, any thoughts on this patient?
No, I think this patient has a horrible disease, and I don't think any of our standard things are going to be very effective, certainly not in the long term. And these are exactly the kind of patients that we want to have clinical trials for. It's just that, none of us have very many of them. You guys are lucky that you were able to compile, a relatively large data set, which didn't give us any good outcomes. But I think it's important that we are really aggressive about keeping these patients on trials. I find that when I have these patients, they end up on multiple trials because they progress and they're our phase one stars, right? They go from phase one trial to phase one trial as we're trying to learn, what we may be able to do for them. I think we're all really eagerly awaiting, these novel drugs coming out, the APR-246, but we'll have to to wait for the data and wait until it's available for everybody to use.
Okay, so I will move on here. So we kind of discussed these options. You know, all of these are options that the NCCN or label use does allow you to use in TP53 mutated AML. I think all of us agree that as by nature, we're all highly optimistic. And so we will try to get them on trials that are showing early data until we learn otherwise, hopefully not, but that will be our goal. And now I'll just have a few slides on another approach with immune therapy that I think is a little bit under the radar. You know, the people here are probably familiar with it, but I don't see it discussed as much in meetings. But there is a randomized study ongoing, so I think it's fair to kind of get up to speed with this. So this is using a radioconjugate-based approach to targeting iodine-131 that's heavily expressed on the surface of not just the AML blast, but also in major lymphocyte population. So this approach is really more of a conditioning approach, trying to eradicate the bad cells, but also many other cells to clear the patient for transplant. And there is a phase 3 randomized study actually ongoing. The study is called the Sierra trial, which looks at patients who are primary refractory. And these are the criteria here, greater than 55 years, and they have to have been either induction failures, early first relapse within less than 6 months, which we know is a very difficult and poor outcome population, or refractory to a first salvage. And those patients should have had a identified donor, and then they are randomized to either receive investigator choice chemo. There's about 10 or 11 options you can get with targeted HMA, high-dose chemo, pretty much anything anybody would really want to use, or you go to the IOMAB, and then the plan is to see how many can be bridged to transplant, and the primary endpoint is a six-month durable CR post-transplant and one-year survival post-transplant. They're really taking our worst of the worst, people who are failing frontline induction or having early relapses, and see if we can carve out something effective for that population. So this is a interesting kind of phase 3 where the way it's set up, the interim analysis are kind of being presented as the study is ongoing. So this was actually the interim analysis when 50% of the patients were enrolled. This was from the TCT meeting. And as you can see, at least the amount number of people who are making the transplant is quite impressive on the IOMAB arm, 100% of patients. And this is irrespective of remission. These are just people who get the IOMAB, get wiped out, get to transplant. And on the salvage arm is pretty much what I would have expected, about 20% or so people, those who achieve remission, make it to transplant. That's kind of our expected remission or transplant conversion with FLAG-IDA or MEC or whatever one may fancy to use. This is the 100-day post-transplant non-relapse mortality. And as you can see, in those who received IOMAB, there was a concern that maybe they will be more myelosuppressed and have more severe neutropenia, thrombocytopenia, and post-transplant events. But it, at least based on this data, looks quite encouraging with a 6% post-transplant mortality as compared to 30%, even in those who achieved remission after chemo went to transplant. And then there was a crossover allowed, and a 20 of those patients out of the 38 who did not respond were able to cross over. And you see that after crossover, they got IOMAB. Many of them could go to transplant. I think 18 out of 20 or so could go to transplant, and they did not have a significant post-transplant mortality. So this is data I wasn't very intricately familiar with. I think this is very encouraging. We have to see what the final results show, but definitely for a primary refractory patient, something I would consider or think of, and we do have the trial open here at MD Anderson currently. There's another trial that has caught some attention. I saw a couple of press releases on it. This is a Actimab. This is another radioconjugate, but now targeting CD33 using an old drug conjugate, lentuzumab, which has been around for many years. And the abstract basically says that there's about 100% response rate, CR, PCRI, in 15 patients, relapsed refractory patients with CLAG plus this antibody. So I think we need to know more, of course, about the duration of response survival. This will be presented as an oral at ASH by Dr. Abedin, and I'm curious to see the data, because anytime we hear 100%, as Gail mentioned, we perk up our ears. So we will see what this data shows at ASH. And now moving towards a number of different antibodies, I'm not going to go through them in detail. Many of these are in phase 2, some being looked at for potential rapid approvals, CD123 antibodies, IMGN that is being done in many centers in combination with AZA and AZA-VEN, flotetuzumab, probably the most advanced among all the bispecifics, that is showing encouraging data also in primary refractory AML, and that's kind of become a potential approval strategy based on about a 35 to 40% CR/CRI in primary refractory AML. And then you have many other bispecifics, XmAb, AMG-330, AMV, that are also showing early responses, but not the same that we have seen in ALL with Blina. So I think there will be more tweaking, maybe MRD space, maybe low burden disease, early salvage, where we can find a better application of these bites, because it has not replicated the ALL Blina story that many were hoping for with the bites in AML. And then there are some new targets. You know, we talked about CD47, magrolimab, APR. A third one that we are also quite excited about is CD70. Early data, again, small numbers, 12 patients, was published in Nature Medicine actually a few months ago, showing very high response rates in the frontline older AML. There are randomized studies of AZA-CUSA versus AZA and triplet studies of AZA-VEN-CUSA ongoing. We will hopefully have more data for those, not at ASH, but maybe sometime next year. But this is another target that we kind of think may have some impact in AML. So in the last couple of slides, this is kind of our approach currently at MD Anderson and other sites. So this was a review we published with other KOLs. You know, basically, we're looking for molecular targeted therapies or biological targeted agents. So core binding factor, trying to carve those out, FLT3 mutated, adding FLT3 inhibitor upfront with transplant, post-transplant maintenance. And then for the others, therapy secondary AML consideration for CPX. And then there is a big emerging data set of venetoclax plus induction, both from the CAVIAT study in Australia and from FLAG-IDA. And that's kind of where we're putting our patients who don't have a FLT3, don't have a core binding factor, don't have therapy related, don't have TP53. And for the TP53, really irrespective of age, we have moved towards the clinical trials with APR magrolimab. We used to debate this a year ago, but now we just are going for those approaches. For older AML, HMA-VEN backbone is kind of what we're using, but efforts to add to that in trial setting, IDH or FLT3 or TP53 targeted drugs. And then transplant, as you see, still remains kind of the goal for many, but with emerging data, maybe we will change our mind in that aspect. And with that, I am going to turn it over to Dr. Gail Robos from Cornell to please discuss her portion.
Thank you very much. And I have a fun job because I get to talk a little bit about targeted agents. But of course, targeted, what does that actually mean? I can kind of talk about whatever I want because there has to be some kind of a target for every agent. So I think that the first target we'll talk about is BCL2. And we've talked a lot about venetoclax throughout this entire discussion. And one of the super interesting aspects for me is that even within the United States, and candidly, even within cities in the United States, there are lots and lots of differences in how people view the role of venetoclax in older patients who are unfit for intensive therapy, not to mention the rest of the world where the drug is largely unavailable. So here we've been talking about this as practice changing, as paradigm changing. I think that you can clearly hear a strong bias, at least from the Cornell and MD Anderson campuses, to incorporate venetoclax plus HMAs for older unfit patients. And yet, what are we actually talking about in this group? So I think you've heard a lot about molecular and biological subsegmentation of AML. NCCN guidelines are still talking about patients older than 60, but actually, I really hate that. And I can't wait till we just stop putting a number on anything. And actually, if you look at most of the data for unfit, so-called unfit AML is now using anyway the Ferrara criteria, which I'll talk about in a moment when we get to the venetoclax data, and that's 75. But some age that needs to be a lot older than I am is going to be the definition for older patients. And basically, we're looking at actionable mutations and then not actionable mutations. And here you have preferred the venetoclax HMA-based regimens. There are other things you can do. There's Glazdegib, there's gemtuzumab, but basically the new standard of care in the United States is actually the addition of venetoclax to an HMA-based backbone. Now, when you get into IDH mutations, here it's confusing because we also have IDH inhibitors that are approved and have data in the frontline setting. We also know that venetoclax plus HMA has very strong data for patients in the frontline setting with IDH mutations. So even here, it's confusing. I can't make AML simple for anybody. There's no hammer and nail model that, well, if you have an IDH and then you have to use an IDH inhibitor. Well, maybe you mix them together, maybe you use venetoclax initially and then an IDH inhibitor afterwards. We'll talk about all of these scenarios. And then, of course, FLT3 mutations. Well, if you have a FLT3 mutation, you're supposed to have a FLT3 inhibitor, right? Well, we also know that that doesn't quite exactly work. So in younger fit patients, the addition of midostaurin to 7 and 3 is clearly better in a randomized trial than 7 and 3. But we also know that, for example, FLT3 mutated patients have some benefits from CPX351. They have some benefits from the addition of gemtuzumab in the alpha study. There are venetoclax-treated patients with FLT3 mutations who go into remission. So even here, it's not easy to figure out what to do, but you can see in the preferred category for patients who are older than 60, who are considered not candidates for intensive therapy, you keep seeing venetoclax and an HMA a lot. And that is certainly an exciting change from where I started a long time ago using HMAs alone, which do not have the response rates and do not have the survival that the combinations do. Now, we've talked a lot about VIALE-A, but I want to bring up just a few points. So first of all, what we had been discussing and arguing back and forth about a little bit is that most people actually think that this was just an older patient trial, but it's not true. You could get onto the trial if you were 18 to 74. You just had to have some pretty major problems. And Harry already said earlier that there is a question about those patients and whether they really benefited. Well, those patients were in really, really rough shape. And it still begs the question of what is the role of age in figuring any of this out? If you look here, the age criteria, again, to not have a million comorbidities was 75. So 75 is the new 60. I guess when I'm 75, I will be hopeful that 90 is the new 75. But whatever it is, the regimen was administered successfully to older patients as well as to patients with multiple comorbidities. This was done in a randomized trial versus azacitidine alone. And you can see here, first in looking at the response rates, that the combination was much better. And then subsequently in looking at the survival, there was a significant improvement in overall survival. And these two slides together, both the response rates and the overall survival, and it's nice that they hung out together because we all know that unfortunately with older patients with AML, that doesn't always work out. You can have upfront differences in response rates that are significant that don't translate into overall survival. Here they did, and this is the standard of care. Now, just because it's the standard of care doesn't mean we've cured all older patients with AML. We have not. The overall survival here is crossing that one-year barrier finally, and there were so many trials with HMAs alone that had people just in the 6 and 7 month mark that seeing timelines that now go beyond 12 and 14 and 20 months is very exciting. But most patients, when you tell them that they're getting the new standard of care therapy, they are not expecting to hear numbers like 14 or 15 months. They are expecting to live forever. In addition to that, there are safety issues that are notable, including monitoring of very significant cytopenias that result in dose adjustments and changes that you've got to be experienced with the regimen to figure this out, especially once the patients are in remission. And there are also significant interactions with concomitant medications that are common, antifungal antibiotics, but also things like carvedilol and other things that older patients take very frequently must be managed because they synergize with venetoclax and there need to be dosing adjustments. So we have a new standard of care, but it's a work in progress, I would say. Now, one aspect of the work in progress that's particularly interesting is to try to figure out, okay, well, why does it stop working for some patients, A, and why does it not work as well out of the gate for others? And we're starting to unpack this. And certainly the presence of TP53 mutations out of the gate limits both the response rate as well as the overall survival. We've heard that several times, but also RTK pathway mutations and other features of the initial kind of mutational complement or mutational picture of the patient are going to be figured out in terms of who's ultimately not going to benefit that much from the regimen or who is going to be benefiting from tweaking of this regimen, either by addition of another agent or by prolonged ongoing therapy. Lots of unanswered questions. Now, the unanswered questions takes me to the new direction slide. And here, what I decided to do was just show everybody how many combinations are in development. And to all of my colleagues, both clinical investigators and in industry, if I have left out your drug, I'm sorry. There are so many abstracts. I haven't memorized them all yet. I didn't want to leave anybody out. And I specifically didn't want to present data because these are all preliminary data. But look at the drugs, azapembro, azapevenitostat, FLAG-IDA, lentuzumab. We've heard about some of these. OPB-111077 is a mitochondrial, an inhibitor of mitochondrial electron transport. There are combinations with old things, cladribine, low-dose Ara-C, alternating with azacitidine. So all of this is really exciting, but it means, part of it means we don't know what we're doing. And part of it also means that just because, again, and I said this earlier, you might have three favorite foods, it doesn't mean that they all play nicely together or make a better regimen. The list goes on, and the data that you can see here that are going to be presented at ASH are significant because if you're on to something good, you want it to be better. Can I put venetoclax with CPX? Can I put it with which FLT3 inhibitor? Should it be with QIZ? Should it be with crenolinib? Where do we do this? And in the United States, when we actually have access to a lot of these, it's great and it feels good to have the access and I'd rather have it, but it's very daunting to figure out combinations. And as Harry said earlier, I mean, again, you can't have a randomized clinical trial for everything. You're not going to have perfect data for everything. This is real people with real medicine. We have to make some decisions, but it's very, very hard when there are 12 patients here and 13 patients there. And how do you actually combine all of these drugs? And these data sets at ASH, I think, are all very convincing about the potential combinability with venetoclax with other agents, as well as improved responses. Now, what about novel combinations with FLT3 and IDH inhibitors? So you get back your mutation panel and you got a little bit of everything. You got a FLT3, you got an NPM1, you got an IDH. Well, I know drugs for all of those things. How about if we move them all together? Well, which one? Midostaurin, gilteritinib, what's going to happen with quizartinib? Sorafenib, which is an oldie and a messy drug, but it still shows major benefits in certain subgroups with FLT3 mutations. Which one of these would you combine? Be careful, because we don't know the answer to that question, and there are potentially overlapping toxicities. Looking at sorafenib, I just thought I would bring this up for two reasons. First of all, sorafenib is still in the game. This is a randomized trial with an improvement in RFS and OS in FLT3 mutated AML patients in remission after transplant. I don't know what exactly this drug does to the immune system, and there are very elegant papers about it, but it's different from other FLT3 inhibitors, and it is something that is quite powerful. But here, if you think about this conceptually, transplant isn't the end anymore. We were trying to cure AML patients. You get in remission, you get a transplant, you're supposed to be done. You're not supposed to need to go on to endless maintenance therapy. And yet, throughout this entire discussion, we've been talking maintenance after induction, maintenance after consolidation, maintenance after low-intensity therapies, and here we have maintenance after transplant. Are you ever going to be done with your AML treatment? I'm not sure for some subgroups. Here, looking at the IDH inhibitors, well, we have IDH inhibitors. We have two good drugs, ivosidenib and enasidenib. They work alone in patients with relapse. They work alone, actually, in patients with newly diagnosed disease, too. But we want to combine them. We want to optimize the outcomes for these patients because overall survival, certainly in relapse disease, is still nowhere near where we want it to be. So what can we put it together with? Well, here we have FLT3 inhibitors and AZA combination in patients unfit for intensive therapy. This is going to be presented at ASH, some initial data coming from Eunice Wang, looking at signals from, you know, what happens when you add in gilteritinib. Should you do this? Well, you can get the drug. Should you just add it in? No, probably not. We need a little bit more data here. What about enasidenib plus azacitidine? These were data initially presented by Courtney DiNardo at ASCO. So again, what about this? Can you get on the bandwagon of, okay, enasidenib works well for some patients, even as monotherapy. What happens if you put it together with azacitidine? Well, the response rates are quite high. You're looking here at CR rates that are significantly higher with the combination versus azacitidine alone. What is going to happen with overall survival? Well, that didn't look the same. So again, going down this pathway of do CR rates always lead to improved survival in older AML patients? Not necessarily, or in any AML patients. I still think CR is better than not having a complete remission. I think there are advantages for patients clinically who are responding. But again, we have to be careful that OS endpoint still remains elusive. And in this combination, again, it didn't turn into a benefit for median OS. What about Ivo? What about taking ivosidenib plus venetoclax plus azacitidine? So you have venetoclax and azacitidine working very well in patients, especially with IDH mutations. Well, what if you double down and add in an IDH1 inhibitor? And here too, there are very promising, encouraging upfront response rates, including MRD negative responses. But is this reasonable to just keep piling drugs together? On the one hand, I think combinations are incredibly important and will ultimately be helpful. On the other hand, we really can't just do this based on 12 patient data sets, which I think we've talked about before. If you look over here, these are some early data that are going to be updated. But not surprisingly, if you had undetectable MRD that was associated with excellent duration of response, and if you get higher response rates by combining these agents, the thinking is that this would translate into better news for overall survival. There are data suggesting, though, for example, for IDH1, that VAF clearance of IDH1 doesn't necessarily result in better transplant outcomes, though. So nothing necessarily in AML land is adding up in an easy way. One and one is just not always coming out to be two. So that leads me to a case of a 77-year-old who came in with newly diagnosed AML with hypertension and coronary artery disease and actually pretty bad RA. And the testing showed normal cytogenetics with a FLT3 ITD, but a low allele ratio and NPM1 and NRAS mutations. So what am I going to do for this patient? Well, you know, again, in the US, we could do a lot of playing right now. There would be a lot of possibilities of putting this, that, and the other on top of each other. But maybe what I'll do is toss this out to the panel to kind of round out our discussion of where, based on what we've learned so far at this meeting and what I've said, where are the data that we could actually point to for this patient? And I'll throw it to Harry because he'll get mad if I'm in the data free zone for too long.
So I had a patient like this recently with a severe CAD and hypertension, and gave him aza venetoclax and cleared the disease from his marrow. And then he blew up with leukemia cutis, and I added in gilteritinib. And so now I have the combination. So basically I took a sequential approach and started with azavenetoclax. And I think that's one of the questions we're really getting at. You know, we've heard Novel and Gail talk about, you know, triplets, and it's not that I'm against that. What I'm wondering is, do we lose the opportunity to understand maybe what we're doing by doing everything at the beginning? And my patients often like the idea that I've got plan B in the pocket. And so for a patient like this, I would have started with HMA venetoclax and added in gilteritinib for, in its labeled indication, by the way, for persistent disease.
Yeah. And I mean, I think that, you know, for a patient like this, I didn't make the clinical aspects particularly excitingly complicated because we had done that earlier. But I mean, this is a, you know, this is an older patient who's really got some comorbidities. Nobody's excited about giving a patient with this list of comorbidities anthracycline-based therapy. And I think here, what I think is important to just note is that, again, it's hammer and nail. And that's what worries me in the current kind of AML landscape, that you're looking, oh, I see a FLT3. Okay, that means I got to whack that one. Well, actually, there are FLT3 mutated patients who will get treated with HMA and venetoclax. And you can wait. Let's see how she would tolerate if you have a tolerability question. I'm not saying you couldn't get started right out of the gate with a triplet. You could. But it doesn't, just because venetoclax is not a FLT3 inhibitor doesn't mean it doesn't work here. Or just because ivosidenib is an IDH1 inhibitor, it doesn't mean that you have to use it by itself for IDH mutations. I think people are desperate to be a little bit reductionist and trying to figure out all of these new drugs. And I think that's hazardous.
Well, I think that's the point, is the tolerability. If you do all three at once and you run into problems with prolonged cytopenias, you don't know really what to do. And one thing we have seen from some of these combination studies, whether it be the IDH inhibitors or FLT3 inhibitors with venetoclax, there is added myelosuppression to doing that, which will take its toll on a 77-year-old with other comorbidities. So that's why I would do a sequential approach, so I can understand the toxicities that I'm adding along the way.
Yeah, and I think that's something we're going to learn, right? I mean, every meeting I've been in is whether you do a triplet up front or you do a doublet, sequentially, and there's different parties. But I think the key is to do those trials, those different trials. Do it with the AzaVen-GILD. Do it with the AzaVen followed by AzaGILD followed by AzaVen-AzaGILD. And we may find there are differences. Maybe there is a synergistic benefit to knocking it out very early, even with the myelosuppression, and then easing off. Maybe there isn't, and maybe you just add a lot of myelosuppression and you could get the same. But I think, you know, and there is data, we didn't mention it, but Marina Konopleva will be presenting a dedicated abstract on FLT3 outcomes with HMA-VEN. And then you get into these really small numbers because we're going to dice it with allelic ratio less than 0.5 and co-mutation. But what we are seeing is those who have FLT3 without NPM1, the HMA-VEN versus HMA benefit is very, very minor. And they seem to be very FLT3 driven. So then do we need to know the allelic ratio now and the co-mutation? I think it's going to become more and more complicated. I mean, we would have probably put this patient on a trial, tried a triplet up front. And the thing with the triplets, though, that, you know, I think will be highlighted with a lot of the presentations is that it's not 1+1. You cannot give 28 days. You cannot even give 21 days. Most of our triplets were giving 14 days of VEN. And then still it's taking about 38, 40 days, but not 60 to 80 days, which it would. And I think even when we say triplet for the community, please do not give full doses. If you're considering it, either send them for a trial or, you know, talk to an expert, because there's a lot of cooking being done to get to that triplet.
I would actually say that would be, in my mind, an incredibly important note to wrap up even the discussion here as a take-home point of, you've got the more elements to the cocktail, the more room for error. And what are you manipulating? Are you manipulating dose? Are you manipulating duration? Are you manipulating both? In which one of your therapies? It's really tough to figure that out. And I would say that to start out with a regimen that has a package insert that you can figure out, that you can carefully go over your concomitant medications in an older patient with multiple other medications, and then very, very carefully make next steps, I just think the patient's literally going to live longer than if one looks at the mutation profile and picks one drug per mutation. I'm scared of that approach.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Robos. I think this is a very stimulating discussion. Great to have all these options, and hopefully emerging data from ASH will give us more insight on these doublets and triplets. So we have limited time. We're going to do a couple of questions. One that I think we touched on briefly, but is very, very critical, especially in community and others who may not have as much experience with venetoclax as some of us on the panel. And I'm going to ask Dr. Robos here on this question. How do you address venetoclax-related neutropenia in your older patient population? I'll add to that, What is your time point for doing bone marrows, and how do you use those to adjust venetoclax durations and interruptions?
So I think it's a super important issue because obviously we want all of the patients to have the excellent outcomes that are reported in the trial. So how do you get there? So rule number one is that there had been previously in thinking for older patients that somehow bone marrow aspirates and biopsies are unpleasant and to be avoided. They need to come back into fashion and very quickly for older patients, because I can tell you that we absolutely do bone marrow biopsies and aspirates on almost every HMA ven patient at day 21. We rarely go to day 28 if patients for some reason had antecedent, you know, MPNs and have particularly high counts. Sometimes we do that, but almost every time on day 21. And what I'm looking for at day 21 is actually a cellularity assessment. If there are a few scattered blasts, that doesn't tell you what you need to know. What you need to know is that, is this a very, very hypocellular marrow? Have you cleared it out? Because if you have, you need to stop. And we actually recommend stopping at that point and using growth factor support to get the patients into their remission, because the likelihood is at that point, if you have an MLFS or a morphologic leukemia-free state at that point, the patient has an excellent chance of going into remission. And then you are starting a subsequent cycle from a point of normal blood counts. I think that it's critical to have that assessment. And okay, if it's not day 21, if day 21 is a Sunday and you need to do it on day 23, that's okay. But it needs to be an early time point assessment to allow you to not proceed with additional myelosuppressive therapy beyond the point of a response. For the post-remission cycles also, I can say that sometimes if you're not on a trial and following the instructions on a trial, you might really need to get your feet wet with a particular patient. And especially if they have had any type of a stormy course during induction, I will often do something like say, let me try 5 days of venetoclax and 10 days, 5 days of azacitidine and 10 days of venetoclax and see what happens. It's, we don't have a ton of data for the post-remission therapy on exactly what is required to deliver the long-term responses from the trial, but it is very clear that dose and schedule modifications were made. And I think it's incredibly important in individual patients to make sure that you're not giving them a cycle that is resulting in 4 weeks of pancytopenia when they're already in remission.
Okay, so one last question. We had a question come in from the audience about how we're approaching frontline therapy in COVID era. And the question is, are we moving unanimously to lower intensity therapy outpatient because of COVID and trying to keep everybody out of the hospital, or are we not? And maybe I'll start with Dr. Lin and see what the practice has been there.
So we have been later to the COVID wave here in the Midwest, but we're certainly taking our turn with it now. Our feeling and our approach has been that AML induction, you know, is an emergency, and we have not changed how we're doing our AML induction based on COVID. We still have inpatient beds for people who need to be inpatient, and if that changes, you know, after the holidays, you know, I'm not sure how we would reassess that, because our standpoint would be, that for patients who need induction, who need intensive induction in the hospital, we would do everything we could in order to continue that. I think things like IDH inhibitors and HMA-based inductions, we do safely outpatient all the time. And so that wouldn't be a change for us.
Dr. Erba, any thoughts?
The bottom line is I don't know where my patient would be safer, on the inpatient service or in the infusion area every day. Having just been on service, been on service for 14 days and home, those are the only two places, and somehow at the end of that, contracting COVID and still recovering from it, I have no idea where I got it. It's out there now. And so I think we're fooling ourselves if we know which place is better. So I'll take a little bit of a different approach to the question. And one of the questions, Ken, that has come up is an all-oral regimen. Are we there yet? I will make sure the audience knows the difference between oral azacitidine and oral decitabine. These are not interchangeable with the parenteral formulations. Oral azacitidine has a completely different pharmacokinetics and should not be just substituted for azacitidine. Now, on the other hand, oral decitabine taken orally for 5 days is a mixture of oral decitabine with a proprietary cytidine deaminase inhibitor called cetazuridine, which prevents the degradation of the decitabine in the GI tract, so allows for very similar pharmacokinetics. So I think it is interesting to consider an all-oral regimen once a patient is in remission, based on the pharmacokinetic profile of oral decitabine and IV decitabine. Those studies I know are being done right now. But then you run the challenge that the drug is not approved for AML, it's approved for myelodysplastic syndrome. So not obvious there. But I wouldn't do it as part of initial therapy when patients are, you know, diagnosed with AML, they're cytopenic, they're having infections, needing transfusions. I don't really think you buy anything or gain anything at that point. But maybe later on, once a remission has been achieved.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think with that, we're hoping Dr. Erba continues to get better quicker and quicker. And I would like to thank everybody here for listening. And I think this was a great session. I enjoyed it. I hope everybody enjoyed it quite a bit. And lots to look forward to at ASH this year. Thank you.
Thank you for listening. Download materials and complete the post-test for instant credit at peerview.com/CHU860. This activity is supported by educational grants from Actinium Pharmaceuticals, Gilead Sciences Incorporated, and Jazz Pharmaceuticals Incorporated.